Somerset Berkley Regional School Committee at 6:05 PM. Due notice having been posted. Pursuant to the open meeting law, any person may make an audio or video recording of this public meeting or may transmit the meeting through any medium. Attendees are therefore advised that such recordings or transmissions may be made, whether perceived or unperceived by those present, and are deemed acknowledged and permissible. We'll do a roll call of members present. Ms. Pereira?
Present.
Ms. Ashley?
Present.
Mr. Fenstermaker?
Present, participating remotely.
Thank you, Mr. Fenstermaker. Mr. Machado?
Present.
Ms. O'Brien?
Present.
Also with us this evening, our superintendent of schools, Mr. Jeffrey Schoonover, our new chief financial officer, Raquel Pellerin, our director of curriculum, Elizabeth Haskell, our recording secretary, Robin McCarl. I would ask you all to please rise for the pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'll ask that you please remain standing so we can observe a moment of silence in loving memory of our Somerset Berkley High School student, Zachary Dean. Thank you. The next regularly scheduled meeting of this committee will be held on Tuesday, September 10th, 2024, here in the Somerset Berkley Regional High School Library. The first item on the agenda for this evening is the introduction of our new Chief Financial Officer, Raquel Pellerin. Welcome.
Thank you.
We are very happy to have you.
I'm happy to be here.
I don't know if Mr. Tara or Mr. Schoonover are going to say anything in introduction, or we just say hi.
Well, actually, Raquel's first day was today, and we were in this room all day with our administrative team, and Mr. Tara has been working very closely with Ms. Pellerin, preparing for today, and they've done some interviews together over the last month for a different position. So I will let Mr. Taro maybe introduce Raquel.
Absolutely. So I've actually known Raquel for a while too. I knew her from a Rhode Island position. She's skilled, knowledgeable. So I really think you folks are very lucky to have her here sitting in that seat. I think she'll do a tremendous job carrying on the things that we've implemented, carrying on what Lindsay started to do, what I continue to do, and I think she's a perfect candidate for this position. I'm happy for her, I'm happy for the district, because I'm at ease now knowing that things will move smoothly and forward. So good choice, good decision by the superintendent and for the school committee. So and I'm happy to work with her to transition and make sure everything works smoothly.
And I'm happy to work with Ron on that transition.
And everyone I spoke with during the interview process, they just said how Raquel is a person of the highest integrity, professionalism, knowledge, just everything that everyone had to say was of the highest degree. So we are very fortunate to have someone coming in replacing Mr. Tara, who has been exceptional for us for the past 5 years, on the heels of someone prior to him who was exceptional too. So we have been very fortunate to have some very strong business leaders working for us, and I know Raquel is going to take us right from where Mr. Tara has brought us and will continue us in the right direction moving forward.
Yes. Thank you.
I'm just going to, well, first of all, welcome. I was happy to get to know you during the interview process. I'm really excited for you to be here. But just a little thing about the school committee that you should be aware of. One, we really do support our students. So whenever there's a need for something that has to do with a student need, please let us know ahead of time. Don't let the burden just to be on you and your team. Please bring us in early. If there's anything, one of the things that I like to know is ahead of time before the bad news hits the news, you know, let us know, because we're here as a team. I believe during the interview, I mentioned about personal time. And I know you had an answer just like Ron and every other. I know it's difficult, but please take time to yourself when it becomes, when you become overwhelmed, let us know ahead of time, because the last thing we want is you to be in a situation where you feel like you're on your own island. When you have a great administration team, you have a school committee that's always going to support decisions made, and you're going to know ahead of time. You're not going to find out here. We try not to surprise you. The only time we do tend to surprise the business manager, and Ron would probably agree with that, is really when something comes up regarding students, and we'll say, well, can we find money for that in the very last minute? Because we're really focusing on making sure our students have the great environment. And with that alone, one of the things that we're doing tonight is even, you know, looking at contracts with our bargaining. All of our employees mean something to us. So that's the only thing that, the only advice that I have for you, and welcome to our team.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. So yes, on behalf of everyone, we're so happy to have you. I don't think it's an overstatement to say we were a little bit terrified in the search, knowing what an amazing job Mr. Tara has done, and we were starting to panic, and then we were fortunate enough to have you apply for the position, and I think we all feel very relieved and very happy to have you here. We're also grateful to Mr. Tara for agreeing to assist with the transition, so it's not completely off the hook yet. We look forward to continuing to bother him a bit.
Thank you. I look forward to working with everybody. I appreciate your comments. I think I shared during the interview that I share the same beliefs with being student-centered, and it's a privilege for me to step into Ron's shoes. And like he said before, I've known him for a long time, and I've really looked up to him. So this is a great opportunity for me as well.
All right. Well, then we'll jump right into it. So the next item on the agenda under business and financial matters is the June financial statement.
Yep. So I did provide you a couple of documents. I provided you a FinStat, and I also provided you a operating statement to show you where we are as far as the operating budget. There's no surprises here. I kept you informed during the year as far as investments in technology. We made some repairs to the HVAC system at the school. We made some security upgrades, and we invested in world language textbooks. So some of those line items you'll see as overages. We fell a little bit short with our school choice revenue, but still within budget, which is good news. Bottom line is, based on just the FinStats, preliminary numbers were at $320,000 to the good. That's before we do the transfer as approved by the school committee of the $200,000 to the OPEB fund. That'll be done. Raquel and I are just starting to drill into the financials to make sure all the audit entries are done that we're ready for. Transfers to various funds, whether it be the transportation bonus account, making sure we're using the federal funds to the best of its abilities. This number will change a little bit, but for the most part, we're in the black, as I had projected, which is good news. And we get money into the OPEB fund. So it's kind of just a high level. There's no surprises. I will tell you, as the school committee said, with her experience, I know the school committee doesn't like surprises, and we don't like giving surprises. So she's very knowledgeable in looking at financials and forecasting and looking at the numbers. So I'm confident she'll be doing the same thing that I've been doing, because she has the same skills. So that's it for the financials. You'll see under the operating budget, though, I just wanted to point out the revenue short a little bit, and that was because of the money built in from last year. As you recall, our E&D funds were in excess, so I had to build in the use of funds to make sure that we brought the E&D down. That was a commitment through the budget process. So you'll see the net difference of revenue to expenses a little bit short. And then it we'll still have the ability to make the transfer of $200,000 to the OPEB fund. So that's a high view of the June 30th, again, unaudited, but I'm pretty confident that it's not going to change that much.
Just one question I just want to make sure. On the revenue for Berkley, that is under the 100%. Was that because of the credit?
It was the credit that happened for FY23 that I don't know why it wasn't applied. I think there was a transition in positions there, and it didn't transition to the invoice, the monthly invoice. So we applied for it this year.
Okay, great.
Yep. Just
want to make sure we're paying our bills.
Yep. Okay. We are.
Thank you. Does anyone have any questions about the June FinStat? Mr. Fenstermaker, you good?
Yes, well, if I could ask if you folks could speak just a little bit louder, I'm having a little difficulty. But hearing you, usually it's the opposite way around. Anyway, I just want to thank you, Ms. Pellerin, and welcome to the team, and I look forward to meeting with you.
Thank you.
Can you hear us now?
Yes, beautiful, thank you.
Teach your voice, got it. Okay, the next item on the agenda then, under budget update, is the Chapter 70 increase.
Okay, so it's right at the end of July, I think the governor passed the FY, or signed the FY25 budget. It did everything that our FY25 budget was based on previously was the $30 per student increase, which was with our 955 foundation enrollment. It was around $30,000, $29,000, but now with the actual FY25 budget of $104 per student, the increase in aid, so the total aid for Somerset Berkley is $10,536,858, which is an increase of $99,320 over FY24. That is an increase of $70,000, this is the key figure, I guess, $70,670 over what our budget was previously based on, what it's been, what the assessment has been based on. So with that change, one of the, Mr. Tower and I talked about this last week, one of the things that he will do is, this is a nice introduction for Raquel to learn about the assessment formula. So we will be going through this, applying these new numbers, figuring out the new assessments for Berkley and Somerset. At our next meeting, we will have that revised assessment for the school committee to vote on, and then we will inform the two towns of what the new assessments are. So they'll go down slightly, but it's obviously it's good whenever there's an increase like this. If you have any specific questions, I'm sorry, Mr. Fenstermaker, I automatically turned my back to the people who are here. I apologize.
That's fine.
Well, that's good news. We'll take it. Any mm-hmm. questions? From? Okay, great. Thank you. If the committee does not object, I would like to have the next item on the agenda be unfinished business, the update on the baseball field improvements. We can move that to next. Can we be all right with that?
Mm-hmm.
Bad. Okay, Mr. Tarrell.
Sure. So at one of your previous meetings, you had authorized me to engage in a conversation with a landscape architect. We've been going back and forth with it. He did provide a proposal initially of $87,000. His proposal would include design development for the plans, survey site visits for the site visit for the plan so that he can use that in the specifications, in developing the plans, specs, as-built drawings, and help construction oversight of the project. There's no way that myself or Raquel or Mr. Carrera would be able to oversee that for a couple of reasons. We want to make sure that the correct soil and mixture of soil, the drainage is done properly, and we want somebody with that expertise to oversee this. After some conversations with the landscape architect, We were able to secure the site survey approved from when the land was built, when the building, I'm sorry, when the fields were built. So for about $3,500, he can recertify those plans, hand them over to landscape architect, and we would take money off his proposal. His proposal would be about $80,000 at that point. So we're talking about $80,000 for him to do everything and prepare us, prepare the bid documents, go out to bid and issue the bids and help us with the bid process. If you're okay with that, then the next step would be is to enter into his agreement, engagement letter with him to start the work and start building, doing the plans. So if you're okay with me paying for the site survey that was done, which is about a little over $3,500, his $80,000 fee, and then go out to bid, and then we'll have an idea once the bids are received, we'll know what the cost is. As you recall, the plan will be to replace the field with sod, so we don't have a long lead time as far as loss of using those fields, the baseball field. We'll take care of the drainage. And we also met with Mr. Francis to talk about shrinking the field just a little bit to be more in scope with the other ball fields within the Interscholastic League guidelines. Everybody that came out, the landscape architect and the contractor says, why is this field so big? He said it was way too big, so we talked about moving the fence up, moving the foul pole lines up a little bit too, so we could repurpose those because they're just stuck in a post. So that'll be the whole scope that we'll be looking at, just, and Mr. Francis is right on board with this too.
Committee, have any questions? Okay, if we need a motion. How do I run this? Entertain a motion to engage the landscape.
Engage in a contract with the landscape architect for the services as mentioned for the renovation of the baseball field.
Motion.
So moved.
Second. Motion by Mr. Machado, seconded by Ms. O'Brien. Any further discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor?
Roll tide.
Right, thank you. All right, Mr. Fenstermaker, how do you vote?
Excuse me?
We need to do a roll call vote to engage in the contract. Mr. Fenstermaker, vote.
I'm missing piece of that, so I'm going to abstain.
I can repeat it, Mr. Fenstermaker.
I'd like to make a motion that we allow Mr. Taro to engage with the vendor and also the site survey for a total of $83,500. Right?
Those were approximately. Yep.
Approximately. I will move the amount to so we can go out to bid for the improvement of the or the repairs to the baseball field. I made the motion.
Okay. So motion by Mr. Machado and seconded by Ms. Ferreira. Mr. Fenstermaker, were you able to hear that?
Yes, I was. Thank you.
Great. And how do you vote?
I vote in favor of the motion.
Thank you. Ms. O'Brien.
Aye.
Ms. Ferreira.
Aye.
Ms. Ashley.
Aye.
Mr. Machado.
Aye.
And the chair votes aye.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you. Progress. Good. Okay. The next item on the agenda under student teaching and learning is evening school graduation.
Sure. I know several of you were at Friday's graduation where there were 14 names, but 13 students were present who received their high school diplomas. Eight of the students went through our evening school program for the past 6 months to several years. We had four additional students who received their diplomas who were attending the day school, but were not able to earn their diplomas in June or on May 31st at the time of regular graduation. And then we had two other students from Case High School, one of whom was also supposed to graduate in the spring, but needed a little bit of extra time to do so. Another student who was not present, who was able to graduate with his class in June, but he was able to do so by taking classes at the evening school last spring. So a total of 14 students went through the program this past year, earning their diplomas. So just congratulations to them. Congratulations to Mr. Aguiar, all the staff who really worked tirelessly to make sure that kids get to that finish line. And as he always says in his keynote, to everyone, there's a lot of prodding along the way, and but he gets them there. He leads them to that point so that they can go on. And he shared a number of those students who are continuing their education at a trade school, at Bristol Community College, at UMass Boston. So there were a variety of kids furthering their education, and a handful who were going directly into the workforce as well. So congratulations to everyone. Congratulations to everyone, the students and the adults who made that possible.
Can I just add one thing? Just for those that weren't there, just for the public's knowledge, it was classic Bill Aguiar when one of the graduates was not going to show up, and he called the graduates' work to make sure that he was there, and he actually had them shift his schedule. But it was just classic Bill Aguiar calling someone's employer just to say, he will show up. And then of course the employer was like, of course the kid's gonna be there, you know. So it was just classic Bill and how much he really does care. You can see that it is a love, it's a hate, then turns into a love relationship with the kids because he is crying. And so kudos to that, and it's always great to see that he really truly does care. Mm-hmm. So
very much. Yes, thank you, Ms. Aguiar. I was also impressed by the how the staff of the, you know, the day, right, sort of sees kids through, regardless of how or when they graduate, that they're there to support them. So the tenacity of the students, obviously, but also our staff and their families, who I think it's like the happiest graduation always. So it's a great event. So congratulations to everyone.
And it was nice this year with Mrs. DeCuro. She asked if she could hand a few of the diplomas out to students who were hers, you know, and she ended up handing the diplomas to everyone. And it was just to see those interactions, because there's the relationships that are built there, and the pushing, the supporting, the challenging that they also do, and then to see it through. Like I was sitting next to Dr. Felsford and Mrs. DeCuro, and just hearing them, the excitement between them as they were talking about the students who were graduating, it was really emotional. So it was great.
Okay. There's nothing else. I don't know, Mr. Spinover, are there any other items?
I just have a couple of just quick informational items, more or less. Dr. Belsford wanted me to share that the tech night that we have is next Wednesday, the 21st. This is that night where we're handing out Chromebooks to our incoming freshmen and to any new students to the school, grades 10 through 12. But it's also a nice way of introducing kids to the high school. So it's a little bit of, you know, they get their Chromebooks, but then they have tours, they come around. So just getting familiar with the school, the students and their families. So that's next Wednesday. One of the topics, and I wasn't sure if Mr. Vieira was going to be here tonight, Ryan, but one of the topics we heard last year from our students was the lack of access to this space after school. And as you know, we've tried to hire a paraprofessional for the library unsuccessfully for 2+ years, but Dr. Brelsford just appointed someone over the past week, so we now have a library paraprofessional. This space will remain open every afternoon until 3:30. The late bus occurs around 3:40 or so, so kids will be able to stay after school, and then for those who need that that bus ride home, they'll be able to get it right after that. We know that all students begin on Wednesday the 28th, grades 9 through 12. As I mentioned earlier, we spent the administrative team, principals, assistant principals, central office, and today content coordinators, we spent the last 2 days in this room, as we typically do, just planning for the year. We had some great conversations, and just the planning regarding, yesterday there was a focus on the district curriculum accommodation plan, and today we really focused on the new evaluation teacher rubrics and just what are the critical things, critical components of that, and really what is our emphasis this year. So just as always, it's a wonderful way to start the year, and just the energy that's in the room, and it's like I always compare the start of the school year to be like New Year's. Teachers, educators, we have really two New Years where, you know, you're setting goals for the year, you're reflecting on the previous year, and just the excitement around a new year is always it's always good. It's positive energy. Did you want to add anything regarding today or yesterday?
It was just time really well spent. I felt like we, and I've been saying this like probably all week as we've been prepping for it. We have a great team. We have a really hardworking, thoughtful group who are really focused on what's in the best interest of kids. And so it is really energizing to work with people who we have different thoughts and ideas, but really the outcomes that we're looking for are so aligned. It's inspiring to me, and I hope that they left feeling that same kind of energy and inspiration, so that we are kind of launching into a really good place and in good space, and so it was I think it was really great.
And then just two other quick things. Officer Robert sent out an email yesterday. I'm not sure if you received copies of that, but just really a letter to families indicating, reminding them of traffic patterns. And as you know, we had a minor accident over at this intersection, Blue Raider Boulevard and Luther, toward the end of the school year. So just trying to minimize the congestion that's over here in the morning and getting just cars flowing through the campus in a safe and orderly manner. So he sent that out. Dr. Prelster, I think, included that in her family newsletter, which I believe went out today. It's just a lot of information for families, and we will also be sharing our bus routes. We'll have those posted on our website very soon, so that information is there. And I know all Dr. Prelster will also share that, so we get that information out in multiple areas. That's all.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Questions? Thank you. I know it seems like it's summer for everyone, but I know it's a busy time for everyone to get ready. So thank you for all your work. The next item on the agenda under new business is we need to establish the date for the annual building inspection, which our next meeting, do we want to do it prior to our next meeting? Or do we need to before that?
That's your call. If I can just add one thing before you jump into this.
Mm-hmm.
This school has been used all summer. It has like no other summer before. And a lot of that has to do with our middle school. This school has hosted all of its regular programs. The high school's ESY program, the kids' summer learning program, the evening school program, acceleration academies for our high school students, in addition to different musical groups and athletic teams, and just there's a lot of activity here all day, every day. And then we added middle school ESY students, we added middle school acceleration academies, which are happening this week. So this school has been nonstop, and I know our custodial staff is very stressed about having it prepared and cleaned in time. And I just keep saying, don't worry, just everyone knows, do your best job. And if there's a concern that when you come through, it's either they're still gonna be in the process, or you know, then once all the other back to school activities start, then people have already come through and it's not maybe as shiny as what it was the last day they put the wax on the floor. So there's, and they've had a really, they have a narrow window in between when everything wraps up and when the new year begins. So I just wanted to put that out there, like there's that level of stress exists in all five schools, but we're here at Somerset Berkley, and particularly for the school this year, it was really used quite a bit.
Well, I think that to reassure folks that we totally understand that, and I know we're not looking for perfection really. What we're looking to do is to see if there are areas that we can identify that may need resources or attention from the committee. So it is not it's never a gotcha to the custodians or anything like that.
I explained that, so. But there's a lot of pride that goes into this, and they want to make sure it's best, and they do a phenomenal job in this school. They really do.
It still looks new.
In 10 years.
Yeah.
10 years, this week, next week. Yep.
So I hope that they will, you know, we know they're going to do the best they can, and we understand that the window is even smaller and that the traffic is even greater, and that's okay. What are the wishes of the committee? Normally we do it at the hour before a meeting. Mm. And that would be about, that'd be like 2 weeks after school.
Yeah. My preference is we call another meeting and do the walkthrough before the beginning of school. The reason why I always hate when I get a phone call, oh, this is happening. And I'm like, well, I haven't been into the school. I'll be there in 2 weeks. I like to be able to say, well, no, we did the walkthrough and that's not true, or the case may be. So I always think it is really extremely necessary to do the walkthrough before the start of the school, regardless if they're still working on it. And this is something that's not new to us because we've seen them still work until the very last minute, perhaps not the high school, but at the other schools. So I would recommend that we do the walkthrough sometime next week before the actual beginning of the school. This way, we can, obviously the fire department has to go through, make sure all the lines, all this, you know, the chairs are not blocking any exits. I like to walk around to make sure that the doors are actually working and they're locked. So I would prefer to do it prior. But with that said, next week, I'm in Memphis.
I was just going to suggest, if you wanted to do it next week, since the Somerset School Committee meeting is happening in this room on Tuesday evening, maybe there would be an opportunity to do it just prior to that, since three of you would be here anyway, but two.
And then the other recommendation that I had was to use the following Tuesday, the 27th, because kids will not have come into the building yet. It will just be staff at that point. And that would give the custodial staff all of next week to do what they need to do and not have us in their way and you know, walking on wet floors or something. So now that being said, I'm not going to be available that 27th because I think it's the athletic night for the middle school. So I won't be available, but don't make a decision based on me.
Madam Chair?
Yes, Mr. Fenstermaker.
Yes, I just wanted to add, I believe that, you know, those walkthroughs are important for a couple of things. One, to see how the building is ready for students, how well the building is ready for students. But also, it's a good way for the staff to really tell the school committee members or try to share with us areas that may be wearing or needing some attention soon that might not be part of the everyday, you know, cleanup of the building. Longer range projects, and I think it's a good thing to look at those, and going through the building tends to open up a lot of that exchange. So that's just my position on visiting the schools.
So, well, how do folks feel about Tuesday the 27th?
I know it's the night before the first day for students. I don't know if that is fortuitous or not. I don't know if that's a good time or a bad time for staff. We're trying to commit to Tuesdays.
The
night before?
Yeah, works for me.
For me?
How about, can we do it earlier, like at 5, so that we can get people through?
If we did it at 5 o'clock, I could participate.
That's okay. I can be early. And that way we can get folks home.
Sounds good.
Okay, so Mr. Fenstermaker, I don't know if you heard, the proposal would be to do it on Tuesday, August 27th at 5 p.m. Would that work for you?
Yes.
Perfect. Okay, let's do that then.
No need to vote that, we're just scheduling.
Yeah.
Okay, excellent.
All right. The next item on the agenda then is the discussion on use of the soccer field for winter ice skating.
Okay, so as you know, as you recall from last winter, we had, it was in early to mid-January, lots of precipitation, and an unknown blockage in one of our drains in the soccer field right here in front of the building. So we had a lot of precipitation, then we realized that something is blocked, and we had a bit of a pond out here. And then the temperature plummeted for several days, and it became the perfect ice skating rink imaginable. And it was frankly, I really enjoyed seeing people ice skating out there. Our hockey team practiced out there. It was nice to drive by on a Saturday and just see families skating out front. So anyway, so we had that brief incident there where we were able to achieve all of that. And then a couple of weeks ago, I received a phone call from the town, from Tim Turner, asking, could we do that again? Could we intentionally now do that? And at the time, I'll say, we were concerned that the flooding was going to damage the grass, damage the fields. And we still have that concern a little bit, if it's depending on how long it's there for, but there was no damage that occurred. And what the town is asking for is, can we block the drains? If we know that there's going to be a drop in temperature, if it's forecasted that we're going to have, you know, 5 days in a row of temperature not getting out of the 20s and nice cold nights, can the fire department or someone come out here, flood our field for us, let it freeze, and then we have for a temporary time an ice skating area for kids, for families of Somerset and Berkley. So that's the question, and so I mentioned this to Mrs. Andrews as a potential discussion item for you, whether or not it requires that, you know, I don't think it really requires action tonight, but just as an initial discussion. And I will say the two concerns that we had that I did bring up to Mr. Turner, one was the potential damage to the fields, which is a minimal concern, but then also liability. What happens in terms of if someone were to fall? So that would require some just checking with our insurance company and seeing what happens. Is just some signage there, skate at your own risk, would that suffice or whatever? So we certainly know that if you want us to proceed to look into this a little bit more, that would be one of the first steps. But with that, I'm curious what your thoughts are.
My first question was, what about liability? God forbid somebody gets hurt, then that would be one of my main concerns. So as long as we're discussing it with the insurance company, unless the town wants to have a separate policy that they want to take care of, that, you know, just in case, God forbid, I just hate for it to come back on it. I mean, I think it's great if we can do it and not cause damage for the town to be able to use it, but that would be a concern.
Yeah, I agree. I think we need to, if we're going to do this, I think we need to be cautious about it. And I don't want to find ourselves in a situation also where it happened one time by accident because Mother Nature decided to rain and freeze a tremendous amount last year. But you know, if we do this year after year, will it cause damage? If it's more of like an annual situation, I don't know. It honestly might be a question for the person coming to fix our baseball fields, right? They're experts in this sort of thing. I don't know. I would just ask them a sidebar question. Hey, is this something that could damage our fields? Because we don't want to end up in a scenario where we have a problem that we then have to spend a lot of money to fix, you know? So anybody else have thought?
I would agree with that. That would be both my concern.
Okay, well, same things. The fields, you know, last year, or when it happened last winter, that was one of my questions. Is that something we can do? And we were concerned that it would ruin the fields. Obviously, we were fortunate that it did not. I don't know if the landscape that we're about to enter into an agreement with will know, but if not, let's find someone who will know. Also, I do believe that we probably should have a separate liability insurance for such thing, if needed. Mr. Murphy or whoever our agent may say, no, it's covered as it is. With the town or with the school, because when we open up that ice, which, by the way, I'm 100% on board, you know, just, I'm not very cautious about it. I'm more just want to protect the town. That's all I'm worried about. And it's not only protect Somerset, but it's also to protect Berkley as well, because this property is owned by both, technically, or at least Berkley pays $1 a year or whatever it is for lease, or we pay the town for lease for $1 or something like that. But that would be my only, but I definitely think every opportunity that we have to give our community access to this property should be, let's do it, because they're definitely still paying for it for the next 12 to 15, 18 years. So,
Mr. Fenstermaker, do you have anything to add?
Well, I guess I would have the same concern that was mentioned, I think, there, that we're having trouble maintaining the fields as we have them now, and maybe we need to correct some of those things and get on a better line before we look at additional use of the fields for the public.
Okay. So maybe at this point, so it's August.
Mm-hmm. We're unlikely to deal with this anytime super soon. It sounds like what I'm hearing from the committee is that everyone has a concern, certainly about the liability piece. We would need more information on that, the insurance carrier, and then an opinion regarding, you know, potential damage. That those sound like the two. We wouldn't want to do any unintentional damage. Sounds like those are the two issues that have come to the top. That said, if those were to be addressed, if you come back, mm-hmm, with information for us that addresses those two concerns, then I think we could, based on that, go from there.
Okay.
It was really cool to see.
And ice time is very expensive, so.
we probably did not get a credit.
We should work on that. Okay, great. Okay.
The next item on the agenda, staffing updates, Mr. Spoonover.
Sure, so you have a list of several or one resignation and a number of appointments that have been made since the last time we met. We do have, so as of right now, we've received a couple of resignations from paraprofessionals. We have four paraprofessional positions that are currently open. All of our teaching positions are filled. We are looking for a long-term sub in our social studies department. So that's really the only teaching position right now. Two part-time hallway monitors, we're looking to fill those positions. And we have an administrative assistant in the special education department. I feel like I'm missing, a lunch supervisor position is also vacant. So those are all the vacancies that we currently have. But as I said, classroom teaching positions to start the year, they're all filled.
Okay, that's good news. Mm-hmm.
not, it's not always easy to do.
Right.
Even though, that's great. Anyone have any questions?
I don't have a question. I did notice that we have a new payroll specialist who's been hired. So does that mean our outgoing payroll person can actually retire? I think that was what the person was attempting to do. Yeah. It's similar to Ron, similar, right? To Ron. Like it's,
yes. You never
so,
know.
Okay, great.
Right, June 30th retirements that are going into the middle of August. But yes, so we're fortunate to have a new payroll person.
And I think that speaks to the dedication of our business office staff, that they make sure that they don't leave us high and dry,
right.
Because we would be. I personally know how integral that one payroll person is for the whole district. Mm-hmm. And I know payroll people just generally, they plan their family vacations, if they're able to even take them, around when it's pay week, right? So this is, you know, this is great that we can allow our payroll person to retire and welcome somebody new into the team. So, okay, great.
May I just say something? I know Ron's not here, but I'm going to a little bit speak for him. But the reason I'm just reiterating what he has said a lot of times, especially this summer. It's not only the payroll people. The entire finance staff has been amazing, and it's not so. When you have that one person who is leaving, it actually has taken multiple people to fill in those gaps. And when you talk about like an amazing, committed team, it is mind blowing, right? And sometimes I'll be in my office and you can hear somebody saying it, you know, and it's time to go home, and you can hear them saying, no, it's fine, I can just stay. You know, and because everybody really, you know, it certainly is the, you know, the power of we, and it's really impressive. So again, I'm not speaking for Ron, but I think that he would definitely have shared that. He probably has shared that with you as you're coming in.
And I've seen it, yes.
And I think that we all have, so just awesome. Including Mr. Caro back there, who is always somebody, how can I help? So, thank you.
Thank you all. Okay, next on the agenda, we have policy updates. We have a whole slate of policy updates for a second reading. I had a couple of tiny little questions on a few. I don't know if anybody had any questions. They're really, one of my questions before we move was on policy BE, the school committee meetings. I think, unless I read it wrong, it looked to me that it said Somerset School Committee. It didn't say the region. And I think we just needed to add the region to that language. I don't know if somebody had too many tabs open right now.
No, you're absolutely right. So the language in the two opening paragraphs were referenced as Somerset Berkley Regional School District, but then down below it only says Somerset School Committee.
This is cleaning up the language. The only other thing I noticed on policy EFD in paragraph one, there's just like a period in the wrong place. I think it should either be a comma or it's a new sentence. It's just a typo, really.
No, back to programs.
Yep.
Yeah.
So again, nothing substantive. And my only other question was on policy EFC, which is regarding free and reduced lunch. Has the state moved to make it universal free lunch or breakfast and lunch, is that permanent or is that year-to-year budget?
From my understanding, year-to-year budget.
Okay, so I just want to that policy stance then. Those are my only few little questions. Anyone else? If there are no questions, then I would entertain a motion to approve the policies noted on this agenda for a second reading with those few minor edits. And this will become a part of the official minutes.
So moved.
Second.
Second.
You can take Mr. Fenstermaker second.
Okay. I have a motion by Ms. Ferreira and seconded by Mr. Fenstermaker, and we'll do a roll call vote. Mr. Fenstermaker?
Aye.
Ms. O'Brien?
Aye.
Ms. Ferreira?
Aye.
Ms. Ashley?
Aye.
Mr. Machado?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Next item on the agenda are Berkley and Somerset Public Schools updates. My friends in Somerset?
Somerset has not had a meeting since our joint meeting, so the only thing I would like to share is you're all invited for those that can make it to our ribbon cutting ceremony at the middle school on August 24th at 10 a.m. I had the opportunity to walk through the school a couple of weeks ago. I feel bad for our custodians because there's a lot of construction dust that now needs, you know, they obviously do the construction cleaning, but now it's really the deep cleaning. So, we'll be taking another tour tomorrow. So, but it's ready for our students. So, you know, some furniture is still missing, but it'll be ready. But you're more than welcome. Well, we encourage you to come and participate because it's quite the building.
Ms. Solomon is not here. All I know off the top of my head for Berkley would be, I know that there several folks in the community, if they're doing their school supplies drive that is underway, that I know is getting lots of donations, and I think some businesses in the area and individual folks have been contributing to that, and that's wonderful to see. And I know, I think the kindergarten picnic, which is always really cool event, is coming up soon. I think it's next week, end of next week maybe. That's all I know. It's quiet as well. At least not behind the scenes, but topics not anticipated. I have nothing. Next item on the agenda, action items for future meetings. Anything in addition to what we have discussed for tonight? Mr. Fenstermaker, any items for future meetings?
I do not have any right at this moment.
Great. Next item on the agenda then would be to consider approval of minutes for prior meetings. We don't need to, pull anything out. In that case, I would entertain a motion to accept the following minutes as presented: the joint open session of June 18th, 2024, the joint executive session of June 18th, 2024, the open session of June 18th, 2024, and the executive session of June 18th, 2024.
So moved.
So moved.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Fenstermaker and seconded by Mr. Machado. Any discussion? Hearing none, we'll do a vote. Mr. Fenstermaker?
Yes. Aye.
Ms. O'Brien?
Aye.
Ms. Ferreira?
Aye.
Ms. Ashley?
Aye.
Mr. Machado?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye. Thank you, everyone. The next item on the agenda is public input. Hi, George. We're good?
We're good.
Okay. And in that case, I would entertain a motion to enter into executive session pursuant to Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 30A, Section 21A7. To comply with or act under the authority of or any general or special law or federal grant and aid requirements, consider the release, redaction, and withholding of the June 18th, 2024 executive session minutes and the June 18th, 2024 joint executive session minutes, and pursuant to Massachusetts General Laws, Chapter 30A, Section 21A3, to discuss strategy with respect to collective bargaining or litigation if an open meeting may have a detrimental effect on the bargaining or litigating position of the public body, and the chair so declares. Somerset Teachers Association and the American Federation of State, County, and Municipal Employees, AFSCME paraprofessionals. And I would note that the committee will not return to open session.
So moved.
Motion by Ms. Ferreira, do I have a second?
Second.
Seconded by Ms. O'Brien. We'll do a roll call. All those in favor, Mr. Fenstermaker?
Aye.
Ms. O'Brien?
Aye.
Ms. Ferreira?
Aye.
Ms. Ashley?
Aye.
Mr. Machado?
Aye.
And the chair votes aye.
Does Mr. Fenstermaker say he'll be participating from a remote location?
Oh, yes, Mr. Fenstermaker, can you indicate that you're participating remotely and in a secure location?
I am. participate remotely and in a secure location.